All right. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Preparation Ape. I, of course, am your host, and one of, who gives a shit? You know what I mean.
Not me.
Exactly. My name's DKP, along with...
Hey, I'm Major Tom.
The abominable Major Tom.
Abominable?
Yeah, like the snowman.
How about the abdominable?
What does this have to do with your abdomen?
Because it's sexy.
Well, show it off. We'll get some coins.
Gotta get them. Can we get Bitcoin?
Well, no, you can get those little coins from, like, my free cams, and people can send you, like, sex toys, and you can, like, I don't know, try them out.
It works for me.
Free presents, you know?
So I'm gonna do a quick spiel.
Okay.
So, we're Chainsaw Ape. We stream pretty much every night of the week. And every Friday at 9:30 p.m. Central Standard Time, we bring you a talk show. So it's right here on twitch.tv/chainsawape. So make sure you check out our stuff, and if you for some reason missed this, you can check us out on YouTube. That's my spiel.
Indeed, they are uploaded every Monday.
Yep.
I mean, they're also in the archive. You can do every. You can, we give you options, and that's what's important.
Everybody likes right? options.
So this is episode number 5. We have made it 5 weeks.
Five weeks. I'm so impressed with us.
Yeah.
We haven't been taken off the air yet.
No, not yet. Yeah. The FCC's always trying to take us down.
It's bound to happen eventually.
Well, I don't know. They don't really apply, but... Yeah. Preparation Ape's on everyone's radar. You know that, and I know that.
That echo man is
gonna... No, it's driving me nuts. They're gone now. So, what's on the agenda tonight?
So, you know, usually we try to plan the topics out as early in advance as possible.
Yes, we do.
This has been a crazy week for both of us at work.
It certainly has been.
And... Yeah. So this week, we decided to just talk about the video game industry, and specifically the future of the video game industry. What we think it means, what we think is going to last, what we think is not going to last. So we're just going to kind of go through a couple of different ideas.
You can talk about that. I'm probably going to do a whole bunch of bitching and moaning.
That's fine. There's two important things to note here. Number one, we are not experts of this. We are not video game analysts, so anything we say can be taken with a grain of salt.
I disagree.
That's okay.
I mean, would you rather listen to us or fucking that Patch dude? Who, like, doesn't... Patch Attack or whatever
Pack
it was?
Oh, Pack Attack.
Oh, is it Pack Attack?
Yeah.
I thought it was Randy Patcher.
Michael Pachter.
Like, he'd fucking patch and game something.
No.
I'm not gonna... He's not patching games.
Michael Pachter. I would say he knows a little bit more than us. Yeah. He's got industry numbers to look at.
Yeah, but he doesn't understand video games, though. And let me pose how I think this is going to play out. I think it's going to play out like this. You're going to say, this is how the video game industry is probably going to go, because of this, because of that. And I'm going to say, man, I really hope it fucking doesn't, because that blows. No, they can't do that, because that fucking blows on behalf of, like, people, you know, gaming enthusiasts rather than just... gamers who play games. It's probably going to be a bit of back and forth like that.
So, I think that that's partially true. I do believe that, one, there's... I guess let me go back to my second point. My first point is, we're not experts. My second point is, the one thing about the video game industry is, it's never ever consistent. You hear people saying, like, oh, you know, last generation was the last generation of consoles. Video game consoles have never sold better.
Well, I mean,
in a faster time period.
You see, that's what makes us experts, though, because we've never been conspirators and said that.
Like, so I remember 10 years ago them saying, like, the PC gaming industry's dead. And now it's booming and bigger than it probably
has
ever been.
See, we've never said that, though, and they're wrong. So that makes us the experts.
Okay, I can appreciate that.
Yeah. We're like fucking 10 for nothing, man.
There's a lot of, I guess, ebbs and flows with the industry. A lot of... times where things change. You know, people said, like, mobile or Facebook games were the future. The Zyngas of the world were going to eventually dominate the gaming industry. And that didn't really necessarily pan out. So, the big thing that you see is that, like, it changes. Mm-hmm. There's always change. So, even everything that we see, like, doesn't necessarily...
Well, we'll get to that.
Or predict. All of our predictions may have, like, no meaning whatsoever.
We're already getting into our talking points, which I think absolutely. Is... not good.
Nah,
so how about this? How about we hit the next page? You ready for this?
Yeah, let's move on.
Our seamless transition. 1, 2, lift off. Bam!
Look at that.
That was fucking incredible.
All right, so I guess we can just kind of jump right in. So the first thing I really wanted to talk about is the pricing models for games. Mm-hmm. If you think about the different pricing models, back in the day, you kind of had the consoles that you could buy, like the Ataris and things like that. And those were like $100, $200, right. Something like that. And then you had the arcades that were popping the quarters. Mm-hmm. And then it kind of evolved into like a console world. Digging that American Eagle hoodie, Major Tom. Oh, thank you so much. So, we've kind of gone through a lot of different transitions with gaming, where we focused on cartridges, then we focused on discs. Digital's kind of become a thing. And there's been all these different pricing changes. So, even as far as, like, we used to get expansions, and now we get DLC. They're basically the same thing.
But, you know, now that you mention that specifically... People didn't really bitch about, like, going to the store and buying a physical expansion.
Yeah.
But on that, there is a little bit of a difference, which was an expansion was, like, a fucking, like almost, like, a third of a new game.
Yeah,
like,
absolutely.
It was an expansion.
Yeah.
DLC, like, you're going to pay about the same amount, depending on, you know.
Yeah, well, that's kind of the thing.
But it's always different. So much smaller. Now, Bloodborne, being an example of a good way to do it,
yeah.
Which is, basically, it's more considered an expansion. It's a huge addition to the game.
Absolutely. New weapons.
And doubling the amount of weapons and items.
And a new area to explore and all that kind of stuff. And then,
but for
then
the you same have price the, yeah. as all the other DLCs.
Yep. And then you have the Batman Arkham Knight season passes of the world that are $40 that so far have not lived up to what they claimed that they would provide.
So the season pass thing, I honestly thought... Now, this is going to be weird, because a lot of people don't like... They think, like, well, you know, EA's kind of the one who made season... And they are... They were the ones that did the season pass first.
Yeah.
And it was for what? Like, Tiger Woods or something, I think?
You're talking about the online pass?
No, the season pass.
Where you could just, like, pay...
Oh, no, wait, no, they did the online pass first. Oh, yeah. Anyways, my point is on that. The Arkham Knight is a horrible example of, like... Not a horrible example... Like, an example of what's done wrong.
Yeah.
Now, if you want to take, in my opinion, one that's done right, Battlefield 3 and 4. The Battlefield Premium, I think it was like $40.
Yeah.
And you got, five map packs?
Five different map packs that usually came with weapons and stuff like that. But then it also gave you a bunch of little extras, like priority and the queues. I don't really have an opinion on that kind of stuff. But...
Well, but the thing is, people are bitching all over about that, right?
Yeah.
But I think that some people forget, and Zod, you'll remember this, fucking Halo map packs?
Yeah.
Remember when, you know, on Xbox Live, the Halo map packs would come out, and they were pretty fucking expensive, and if you didn't buy them, you couldn't play online?
Yeah. I remember the Halo 2 map pack specifically that came, like, you could buy it on a disc for the original Xbox.
Yeah, at least with Battlefield Premium, one, you could still just play online, not those maps, for one, and two... Like, if you bought all the Halo map packs, and I might be fucking absolutely wrong on this, but I don't think I am, it's more expensive than Battlefield Premium is, for the amount of content you get.
Perhaps. I'm not 100% sure on that. But.
Well, hopefully we don't get... Hopefully the non-watchers won't call us out in the non-comments.
Yeah. YouTube comments are going to tear us apart, but that's okay. Educate us. But yeah, like, as far as the future goes, I believe that pricing models are going to continue to evolve, and I think that they're going to... continue to range from the 99-cent games, free-to-play games, and we'll definitely touch on free-to-play games here.
Oh, we certainly will.
You know, all the way up to the $60 games, and then even larger. I think we'll actually get to a point to where, you know, a game may run $70, $80.
So something to think about pricing models, too. So, back in the days of Super Nintendo, that sort of thing, right? Mm-hmm. Look in the old catalogs, like the Sears catalog, that sort of shit, Radio Shack.
Yeah.
Games were still like $50.
Yeah.
And do you remember, was it 2009 when it made the jump from $55 to $60?
I think it was specifically when they went from the PlayStation 2 Xbox generation to the 360, which was 2005, 2006.
So yeah, I guess it was longer than that, but like... So you're taking 20 years where it was like $50.
Yeah.
And then that's when game development was cheaper.
Yeah.
And then it's exponentially more expensive.
It takes way more people than it ever has
and
before to make it.
To match inflation, it's only $5.
Yeah. Well, I think that what you're doing is you're helping explain why we do have DLC.
Well, that's
why we do have.
That brings me to my next question for you and for anyone else. So, would you be willing to pay $70 for a game, an extra additional 10 flat cost, like every game's 70?
Yeah.
In exchange for no more DLC, it's all included. Or you get it for free after the release.
I think it depends on the scenario. I think that there are, like, let me think of a game. So let's say if it's something like a new Last of Us game, and they're like, it's $70, but all DLC, all map packs, all anything tied to multiplayer, anything tied to, if we release a single player content, all of it would be free. It actually kind of reminds me, there is a, so Hitman recently, actually, I think it was last week, Hitman was supposed to launch in December of this year, December 8th maybe. And it was supposed to include, it was going to be, I think, $60, you buy the game, and you got like three areas, and like five or six missions. It's episodic,
is it not?
And then after that, every like week or two, you'd get new content. They would add new levels, new different like pieces of content as far as like new...
But for a price?
Yeah, or so what they're actually... What they actually did is they came out and they kind of announced more details on it.
Right.
And what they're doing is it's now coming out in March. If you want to just buy the base game where it's just like three or four different maps, I think it comes with like 800 separate contracts, which is probably you just killing every person in the entire
world. Boy, I mean, if it's three areas, it's like, hey, you killed the cook.
Yeah.
Now kill
this contract is kill the taxi driver. Yeah.
Now kill the sous chef. Yeah. I'm like, all right, well, fucking Jesus.
Now kill the dishwasher. So... Now in March when that comes out, you can pay $35 and just get that.
So then if you want to buy, selling it a la carte,
yeah. Basically. Or if you want to buy everything, you can pay the $60 price tag and you can get everything, like the game, and then every time
all the DLC comes out after that.
Yeah, right. Absolutely.
See, that is a and we're talking about Hitman, by the way. That is a definition of it being done right.
Yeah.
The whole DLC pricing model thing. What if? How come we haven't seen a game? It's possible, but it'd be really fucking weird. So games like Metal Gear Solid, Hitman, that sort of thing, right? Where you would just have a game that continuously goes on as long as a television show would. Episodic content that goes that long. Yeah. That's not an MMO, right?
Yeah. Well, I feel like, we're talking about the future. I feel like something like that is inevitable. I think we will get to a point to where it's no longer like, you know, every couple of months you get like a Walking Dead episode one, then episode two, and
that's kind of different.
And
then
there's a whole other season, but I'm specifically saying like they'll get to a point to where like maybe once a month or even once a week if it's physically. I feel like from development standpoint, once a week is not possible.
No, absolutely not.
Once a month for like ever, you just pay, you know, you pay like a subscription fee or something of like $25 a year, and then you always every month you're going to get a new chapter.
You know, if people pay $15 for a World of Warcraft subscription, right, including like myself, I think I still do, even though I haven't played it in like 2 years.
Yeah.
I would gladly pay that same amount to get like new Metal Gear content every month, even if it was just 2 hours of content.
For sure.
Right? Something. That's really weird that no one's really taken advantage of it. Now people have said like, oh, well, Walking Dead and all that, but that's different because that is basically a full game released in parts that equals up to like a 10 to 12 hour, you know, regular feature length game, if you will.
Yeah.
So yeah, no one's really done that as far as I know yet.
I don't think so, but I do see something like that happening in the future.
I just hope they pick the right IP for it.
That's kind of the key. And really that's going to be the key to how successful a model like that is if they find the right game, then, you know, that could take off and become a huge thing. And it just stuff like this, it's just been kind of evolving within the industry, and it just continues to branch off. And I think it's going to continue to do that. I think it's going to continue to branch off, and we're going to see lots of different alternative payment solutions and things like that to be able to get content.
Well, I suppose we'll have to, like that. Have to see. What about that crowdsourcing?
So, I think it was 2012 when the whole Kickstarter thing started taking off.
When it got big,
Broken Age, Tim Schafer, and his Double Fine Studio.
If you go back and look at
that one, that
original pitch video still holds up to this day.
Absolutely,
I didn't really give a shit about the game when it came out.
Kind of on an unrelated note, did you watch the documentary that accompanied the?
I watched it as it released for like three episodes, and then like once I saw the concept art for the game, I was like, oh, it looks like a child cartoon. I just kind of stopped giving a shit. And I got the I got it for free, and I booted it up and was like, I'm feeding this kid cereal, and it's like, I just really don't give a shit about it. And it's not that the game's bad. It's not Tim Schafer's fault. It's just like, I guess I was thinking more like Gabriel Knight or Myst or something.
Yeah.
And it was like, got the dude from The Hobbit.
Elijah Wood.
It's all bright and colorful. It's cel-shaded.
Yeah. I mean, that kind of stuff works for me. I love those art styles. Well, on a completely unrelated note, That game's going to be free on PlayStation Plus next month. Or the month of October. So
I'll make sure not to play it.
Next Tuesday. Next Tuesday, if you subscribe to PlayStation Plus, you can get it free. So, yeah, as far as like crowdfunding goes, I think it's really fascinating that we see. One of the things that I really like is there's a lot of IPs or franchises that we're getting kind of revived or reinvigorated. So Igarashi did it with Castlevania. The guys who created Banjo-Kazooie after they left Rare, they did, what's it called, Yooka-Laylee. Our boy Keiji Inafune with Mighty No. 9. Not feeling the Mighty No. 9 thing?
Have you not seen...
No, I mean, I know the woes of the development and the promises that were made. But
it looks like shit.
I don't know.
Like, I'm
it does have that cartoon look that you're not a huge fan of.
No, it's, dude, it's... It looks like a 3DS game, but like a poorly made 3DS game.
I'm pretty sure it will be on 3DS, which kind of makes sense. I don't know. I mean, I'm definitely going to get it.
Here's what I mean, and go and look at the concept art for it, and look at like the early demonstrations for how they said it was going to look.
Yeah.
And then look at the finished product, and you're like, what the fuck happened?
Yeah.
You know, but that's, I don't know. I'm still going to play it. I'm going to try it out.
Definitely.
I didn't Kickstarter because I didn't have money at the time, but I just got to say, like, I don't have high hopes for it. And I think that is the number, that's probably the first official, like, real, like, people are feeling the pain from what crowdsourcing is. You're gambling. Yeah. A lot of people think of it as, like, you kickstart a game, right? And you're essentially just pre-purchasing a copy.
Yeah.
But that's not what it is. You're making your pledge to it. And whether it comes out good or whether it comes out bad, that's kind of, you bit the bullet. Now you gotta, you know.
It's like a combination of investing in a game while pre-ordering. You pre-order the game because you're not getting anything on top of the investment. It's not like you're going to get a kickback.
But the way that a lot of people think about it is like, hey, I'm just pre-ordering this game. Like, it's coming out.
Yeah.
It's definitely going to be here. It reached its goal. Fuck yeah, right? That's not the way.
Shinmue 3 is coming, bro. We're getting Shinmue 3.
Are we, though? Like, I put...
Absolutely. We have to at this point.
I put $500 towards Shinmue 3, so I've done my part.
Yeah.
And if it doesn't come...
It's got to come. It's got to. I mean, the fact that it was announced on Sony's stage at E3 last year, or this year,
but look
proves that there is investment from outside of just Kickstarter and the fans. Like,
no, I know that, but just, dude, I'm worried about it, man.
I think that's a legitimate concern.
Not to derail at all, because we're not, but I that is like one of my favorite game series.
Yeah.
I like almost wanted to weep when I saw we were getting the third one, or even the possibility.
What a crazy E3.
And I'm just so worried that it's not going to do well, or it's going to be like really just a bare bones Shenmue. It's not going to be good. Especially after the Mighty No. 9 thing came out, and it was like all that hype, and then you see what it is, and you're like, oh.
I'm still very excited for Mighty No. 9 and Shenmue. But as far as like it being the future, I think it's going to be a big part of our future.
I'm just trying not to get my hopes up so I don't get disappointed if.
Yeah.
Because that's a big one for me.
You know, a couple of examples of ones that I kickstarted. Pretty much everything we just named, but Hat in Time, which is another like 3D N64 style. No, collectathon. The Alpha and Beta came out, and they're both, you know, pretty solid. Road Redemption, which is a spiritual successor to Road Rash, which is going to be really cool. And just game. I mean, even
what was that? I think really? Your Kickstarters are way cooler than mine. I have Shaq Fu Reborn.
Yeah. Shovel Knight, like my favorite game of 2014, that was a Kickstarter game. So
yeah.
There are success stories from Kickstarter, but...
I'm trying to think. So success stories, as far as I know, there's... Okay, so I've pledged for, there's a game called Scratches, which was...
Never heard of it.
It's a point and click, right? Of made by the guy that did, I don't know, some other horror point and click game, right? And, dude, this guy has been writing these fucking, like, 9-paragraph updates, like, once a month. And they're so, like, no one can be reading them. They're so long, and it rambles on about nothing, and it's like, dude, I'm halfway thinking, like, you don't really have a game, and you're just trying to really make it look like you're putting in the time. You know what I mean? Because it's a point-and-click game. It's pre-rendered. You know, you move around.
Excuse me.
I don't remember exactly how much it cost, but it had decent... And that was, like, 2 years ago.
Yeah.
I'm like, how the fuck... Dude, people do, like, game marathons and make shit like that over a weekend. What do you... I don't know. So there's that one. There's Shaq Fu Reborn.
Yeah.
Bloodstained.
Yeah.
I put, I think, 250 towards. Just enough to get the box signed by Iga so I can have that in my collection. And, God, you know, I think... I'm pretty sure there was a couple other ones that I did kickstart, but either they died and I forgot that they existed and just stopped getting updates. Because remember, there was a time when Kickstarter was new, that I was all about it, right? Like, $20, $20, $50, whatever, like, no big deal, it's not a big investment. And I can only think of two games, or like one or two things that have actually made their way to me, and Broken Age is one of them, that I actually was like, oh, here it is.
Yeah.
And that's it. The rest of them are just gone, so. I don't know, man, that's, and the thing is, about the whole crowdsourcing thing, the whole, like, not a checks and balance, like a fraud system, right? Like, there are the guys that were in the news recently for, actually, there are a couple different ones, but the newest one was this guy just ran away with $30,000.
Yeah, I saw that.
And it's like, what's your recourse? And Kickstarter basically is like, well, you need to contact that guy and ask for your money back.
Yeah.
And it's like, well, yeah, what if he didn't have an email? Or what if he just like, well, I'm just not going to pick up the phone.
I think there will be scenarios like that, but I think you just have to kind of be mindful of it. And, you know, somebody like Keiji Inafune or Igarashi or even Tim Schafer, like, I feel like those guys are such large figures in the gaming industry.
But that's kind of not what that was originally supposed to be used for, though.
For sure. No, I completely agree. It's realistically, those guys could probably get a publisher to assist them. I know Igarashi had a lot of trouble to get Bloodstained going, but generally speaking, they probably have alternatives. Mm. But yeah, I don't know. As far as it being something that we're going to see more of in the future, I definitely think we'll see more of it in the future. And to be honest, like, I wouldn't be shocked if our boy Hideo Kojima, you know, took to something like that to either finish, you know, his vision for what he wanted to do with Silent Hills.
Dude, people have said that, and I don't want him to. We know this dude can't budget well as far as development resources. And, like, I love him to death, but dude has a money problem.
For sure.
Can't fill a checkbook, you know?
Yeah.
Or can't balance one.
So, another thing I really want to touch on is, we did kind of mention, oh,
it's okay, Major T.
Did we disappear?
No.
Oh.
There we go.
So, we did kind of mention that,
Hamana.
The consoles. We talked about the consoles. And a lot of people were saying that, you know, that last generation, or this generation, would be the last time that we get dedicated video game consoles. And I wanted to get your thoughts on that.
Well, for one, that's absolutely not true.
As far as
Nintendo has already said, they're coming out with another console.
For sure.
So unless you consider that part of this generation.
Which I don't, personally.
Yeah, me neither.
I consider generations tied to years, not necessarily, like,
and
power.
No, I just don't think, I don't think consoles will eventually have to go away, because, like, financially, they're not feasible, right?
For
it's
sure.
not the best. The whole streaming platform thing, like streaming games, and there's going to be a lot of this. We're discussing the future of the industry here, so there's going to be a lot of, I think this is what's going to happen.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, I think this is what's going to happen. Right?
As far as cloud-based gaming and things like that?
I think that's kind of the way it's going to go.
Yeah.
Maybe not fully, but it's going to be trying to push that way, and the majority is going to be that way.
I do think it will be a longer transition than a lot of people are predicting. I think, like, the next group of consoles we'll see will probably not be disc-based.
They'll probably be the last.
We'll start digital only, and then we will jump to streaming only, and then we'll jump to the point to where it's, like, built into your television, kind of how a smart TV is, something
now,
like that.
The other possibility, and this one I wouldn't mind, is, like, Steam boxes. Right.
Okay.
So what is the whole point of a console? You used to have, and you still do to some small extent, the fucking console wars, right? Talking about, you know, blast processing and bits and all that shit, right? Like, that's not what we talked about anymore. It's just like, well, Xbox is better because, you know,
it's got the Kinect.
But, like, that loyalty, in all reality, shouldn't be there. Like, when it comes to the consoles, like, I like PS4 because I like PS4 better. I like the controller better.
Yeah.
The exclusives.
Well, I think that's kind of what the console war is now.
Well,
it's discussing, like, what are the little smaller items that you know, I like the way that the friend system may work in one.
But back in the day, the console war was like, yours sucks
because
this one is objectively just fucking better.
Mortal
look
Kombat
at these graphics,
on Genesis
look
has
at
blood, stuff like that.
Listen to the sound on the NES, it's way better. Like, now, if you, this whole Steambox thing, right? If you, what, like, so what do people want? It's not the allegiance anymore. If they just, people want just to buy something and it pretty much to fucking work, right?
For sure.
Because, like, people that don't play PC, they don't want to fuck with it. And
that's,
I fully get that,
yeah.
Right? Like, exactly. I get that. But the Steambox thing, right? You just buy it. It's pre-assembled. You don't really got to fuck with it. Plug it in, and you have a controller. You can have any controller you want, yeah. right? And that's it. And I think that if we integrated to that, that'll be beneficial to some degree, because Microsoft and Sony wouldn't have to have this pissing contest to get out new hardware that's at a standstill, and they could really focus on, you know, beefing up their development studios for yeah. software, you know, for games, for development.
So, I actually disagree with that. I feel like, for one thing...
Is that having... the hobby I think it is? Hello!
Hey, buddy!
How you doing, kid?
So, I personally think that, as far as Steambox is concerned, there are too many options. I think if you...
I'll agree with you on that.
But if you think about it from the perspective of somebody who's like, I just want to go buy a video game console. I don't want to have to, like, choose the particular type of controller I'm using, or I don't want to have to choose particular pieces to make it all work. I'm a 13-year-old kid or whatever. I just want this particular box for Christmas.
Well, if you're a 13-year-old kid, you ain't fucking going out and buying a PlayStation 4 anyway.
Yeah, but your mammy might be buying it for you.
Then say, Mammy, I want the good Steam box. That way I can play on max settings. Jimmy across the street, that poor piece of shit, only has the little Steam box.
And you're basically proving my point is, like, kids don't necessarily, or a lot of people in general, a lot of people that buy consoles. If you think about, like, the guy who just plays Call of Duty or Madden every year, he's not going to be like, give me the, you know, whatever Steam box that can do specific things. Like, I want to be able to play...
I think you're thinking of it wrong. Let's pose it this way.
Okay.
All games, you have your settings, high, medium, low, right?
Yeah.
And it's like, well, I don't have a lot of money, and I'm not really super big into gaming. I don't give a shit about 60 frames a second, right? Oof. So I can spend $200 and just get one of them, just play the games.
Yeah.
People that are enthusiasts who want 60 frames a second, who want, you know, ultra graphics, are like, well, you know, I'll pay the $450 and we can both play them, both have fun with them, be developed for one platform, but, you know, just depends on how much you want to pay.
Well, you know those options exist now. I mean, significantly more with Microsoft, but you can, like, you think about the 360 days, you can go buy a 4-gig arcade version of the 360, or you can buy the Elite version that's 320 gig hard drive space or whatever. Like, there is a new Xbox One coming out that actually comes with it's half solid state drive, half regular drive. What are those called? I can't remember.
It's half like a, and half?
Yeah, it's like a split something. I can't
Zod, think. You might know.
Zod, and if I you have half solid state, ultra settings. Half things with the gears and the turning. I don't know what you're talking But anyway, about. There is another Xbox coming out for $500 that is that. It's like the hard drive actually is half solid state. And it comes with the Elite controller that's got all the customizable options and things like that.
Okay.
And that's like the high end that you can get
for
$500. So
basically it's like,
or
hey,
you can get the
lower
end that's 500 gigabytes that, you know, may not come with Kinect or may not come with a nice controller. Just comes like the standard set for like $350. Yeah, so options like that exist
hybrid
now.
Drives, okay.
Hybrid
drives. I've never heard of those.
Yeah.
But so like, but the whole point behind Steambox in general, or maybe it's not their point, but the reason why I think it'd be good is, you know, stop having Sony and Microsoft jerk each other off. Like, make games. Like, they have good development studios.
Well, and that was the other thing I wanted to get into is, like, competition has always been healthy for any type of industry, not just the gaming industry. Competition is just...
Then have multiple Steam boxes. Because the thing is, like, you can have releases.
Yeah, but you don't want to have multiple Steam boxes that some will play Uncharted and some will play Halo.
Okay, so the other alternative... We're talking about the future, right?
Yeah.
The other alternative is streaming. Games.
Sure.
And that's, would you rather have Steambox or stream all your stuff?
I would rather stream it. As long as the technology.
Oh, come on. Now you're just.
We're talking about the future here. So I'm just talking about an infrastructure that allows me to stream and has one to one input to where I press a button and he does something on screen where I don't have to worry about if I'm playing
a
racing
game or
a latency. Thank you.
Yeah.
I don't have to worry about any kind of that kind of stuff. So I feel like if streaming and cloud based gaming can get to that point. Like, dude, sign me up.
And you as a collector would dare say that.
It's where we're going anyway.
Yeah, but I'm not a bitch and moan about it, though, right?
That's true.
Right?
And you're talking about Steam boxes. They don't even have disk drives.
No, I know. It's okay. It's when you realize you're being hypocritical that you can then fully be hypocritical.
Gotcha.
It'd be
so
great.
As far as the consoles, I think we still have a few more generations.
I'd
I
say
think
we have
get
one
up to
more.
The, I think
like one full one.
I think we'll hit a PlayStation 6. And then after that, we'll see
think
something
so?
Different. Yeah.
Hmm. What do you think by the time we have PS6, what do you think Xbox One is going to be called?
Xbox 4. I don't fucking know.
It's going to be called, like, whatever. Xbox Banana Peel or something stupid. Something equally as dumb as Xbox One.
Xbox Banana Peel, I'm
not. It's going to be called Xbox Pi, but it's not going to be the Pi symbol. It's literally going to be 3.14 infinitely around the box until it loops off.
I'm okay with that. I'd buy that.
What a stupid name, Xbox One.
As long as they still have the Halos and the Gears of Wars, I'm all over it.
Maybe Xbox Two.
I'd be cool with that, too.
It ain't the Blue Moons, it's them Rolling Rocks.
So those damn Blue Moons getting a DKP.
Like a rock, rolling rock.
The box, he says. Like that? So
don't you talk about my box like that.
So one of the big things right now, and realistically, like personally, this is something that you and I have not interacted with, but anyone who has speaks volumes of it and is claiming it's the future of our industry, and that's virtual reality. So Oculus Rift, which was kickstarted, was purchased by Facebook. Sony is now working on their Project Morpheus, which is now no longer in a project or code name. It's PlayStation VR.
Yeah, that's the problem I have with the whole VR thing, actually.
What?
It's kind of like, hey, what the fuck? What are they? That VR? Fuck! Hey, we gotta get our own VR!
Yeah.
And it's like, there's so many coming out, and it's like,
God, yeah, you think about it, we've been through this before, the phenomenon that is that was the Nintendo Wii.
Yeah.
And it's like, hey, let's get that PlayStation Move.
Well, yeah.
Let's get that Kinect. But that's kind of my question is do you feel like it's going to be a fad like those things, or do you feel like that potentially has the chance to be the future?
As it is now, no. But like where it's going, absolutely. Now, with the future, like where everything is going to be for VR,
no.
It's going to be like, hey, this game is VR compatible, or...
I think that's the big thing, and I think that's what I was talking about in pricing models as well, is there will always be options. There will, for as long as we live, you can still go to like a Pinball's Arcade and play pinball games or arcade games. See, you can play mobile games, you can play console games. I love the tactile feeling of a controller in my hand, so I will always hunger for that feeling.
I'm hungry for that feeling of a controller.
It's delicious.
You can call me Hungry Tom.
Absolutely. Now,
so that's also a drawback for me. Like I was like, fuck, I don't want it to happen.
Yeah.
So let's use Reggie's Law for an example. And to define Reggie's Law really quickly, it's Nintendo always takes two steps forward and one step back.
Yeah.
It's like, hey, you want New Legend of Zelda? Well, of course we do. Well, guess what? There's a new one coming this fall. With motion controls, and it's like, oh, fuck! Like, that's the one thing I didn't want for it.
Yeah.
So, you know, you're playing, you're like, oh, this is great. Oh, enemy. And you swing it around, and it's like, okay. So it's like, that's Reggie's Law. So the thing is with that is, it's like, so you get this new VR tech, and it's cool, right? It works. There are games that are built for it.
I think that's another big thing. Go ahead.
You get, like, you know, Amnesia, those sorts of things. And then there's a game like, I don't know, let's say Shenmue 3.
Yeah.
And you're like, VR integration, Shenmue 3? Okay. But the thing is, it halfway works. And then for you, it's like, well, I'm just not going to fuck with it. I just want to play on regular controller.
Yeah.
That's also compromised because the game is built around being played also with VR if it needs to be. So, like, neither one is quite good because they're both trying to fit it in there. And I'm not saying it's going to be like that permanently, but there's always that pain period when new technology is integrated. And they waste it, or they try to implement it on big IPs.
Yeah.
You know, like, Zelda was a big one. Like, that's the biggest example I can give.
For sure.
That's what I don't want. And it's gonna happen. There's gonna be, inevitably, a game that I've waited for, like, Max Payne 4 or something ridiculous, that gets ruined by shitty 3D integration. No,
I think that's true. Even if you think about, again, like, the Wii, it's like, we're putting a Resident Evil game on it, and then it's just, like, a rail shooter kind of thing. I think the most important thing for VR to even have a chance to be successful is what makes sense, which is the software. And the challenge that they run into is that whole chicken and egg thing, or eating its own tail, where
sucking developers, its own dick, you know.
Perhaps. So you have the developers that invest millions and millions of dollars to develop an incredible game or franchise for virtual reality. And then you put it out on VR and it doesn't fucking sell.
Yeah.
So they didn't make their money back, so they're not going to continue to invest in these huge games. So we're not going to get amazing games.
Well, that's
because people aren't going to buy them.
That's Shenmue, like, by definition.
Yeah.
They put in a ton of money. Objectively, it was wonderful. It didn't sell well. So they're like, yeah, this is supposed to be an 8-part game? Look at the time. We and our funding gotta get the hell out of here, fellas.
Yeah.
On the double. And they just fucking left and left it high and dry. So that's just a risk of really anything. But
for sure. Hobby 6947 says, they should have something to where you can go to and dial all your friends and family from a rotary phone. I'd be okay.
Wouldn't it be cool? Wait, okay, so you're envisioning.
Yeah.
So it's just virtual rotary phone, the game? That's what I'm thinking. You're emulating, I guess, yourself in 3D. Like, wow, this is incredible.
I miss that sound.
You do the rotary phone. All right. Well, I mean, yeah, you could probably just achieve basically the same thing on, like, a touch phone. Which is another thing. Perhaps. Like, in VR, it's like, even dialing a rotary phone wouldn't be good. Because, you know, you're doing it, but your finger's not really in that hole. You don't get, like, the... No, I'm not going to use the term...
tactile
I'm not going to use the term tactile feedback of... But how's that going to work, though, you know?
I don't know. I think they'll figure something out. But yeah, I think the software is very important. I think it's really what's going to affect it.
Sorry about the delay, my friend.
Damn this delay! Yeah, it's a 15-second delay from the time that you type something in to the time that we actually see it.
You should write Twitch and let them know you're upset about it. By the way, when we tweeted this out, did you at Tom Hanks?
Of course I did.
Fucking hell, all right, good.
Anytime we tweet out that we're going live, which you can follow us on Twitter, at Chainsaw. Anytime we tweet out, we always tag Tom Hanks, because... He's going to come in.
One of these days.
People are going to reach out. They're going to find us through Tom Hanks.
One of these days he's going to come watch us.
I hope so.
One day, babe.
And I can tell him how great I thought he was in Forrest Gump.
I typed this 18 seconds ago, says Hobby H.
Yeah, it's nothing we can do, my friend. I'm sorry.
Yeah, unfortunately, that's
it's
just the way.
Terribly, it's terribly such.
The
awful.
Internet works.
That will be fixed in the future, they've told us. Tom Hanks called and said, hey, fellas, remember me and Big? Nah, it's all right. I know it's okay. Well, anyways, they're going to fix that old Twitch thing, and then I'll come watch. And I'm like, one of these days, we're going to get Tom Hanks. Yeah. Just got to keep tweeting him.
Absolutely. So, yeah, I think VR has a strong chance, but I really think it's dependent upon the right software and pricing. Pricing is important. Sony has said that it's going to launch VR similar to a console launch. So does that mean they're going to treat
it
like a console
launch? They also said the pricing
model
is going to look similar.
Yeah. So are we talking $400? And if so, does it come with games? Does it come with the camera? Does it come with the Move controllers? Compensation, says Caitlin.
You know what? You're right. We should receive some. You can donate below.
I think she's saying that we should give her the compensation.
I understand that, but I thought that we could turn it around on. Perhaps make a little bit of more.
That tip jar. So, let's move on. So,
handheld versus mobile is the next talking point.
Absolutely.
Have.
And really,
what say you?
So, really, handheld and mobile are kind of the same thing now. If you think back. 25 years ago.
If your phone has a joypad, then I'd agree with you, but...
Think back 25 years ago, Game Boy came out, followed closely by the Game Gear, and then we got the Atari Lynx or whatever. We got a bunch of different variations of handheld devices.
It was awful. Terrible.
Yeah. And, you know, then we got the DS and the 3DS.
Yeah.
And the DS sold incredibly well, I think somewhere...
And then the new DS.
And then the new 3DS. Yes. And then the DS Lite.
And then the fuck all those other ones. Those aren't new. This is
the
for real
DSi,
new one.
And then the DSi Lite. And yeah.
Come on.
The DS actually sold, like, I think somewhere close to 140 million units worldwide. And I think the 3DS has sold 40 million units in about the same amount of time. So it's clear that the handheld industries, as far as handheld dedicated gaming platforms, are kind of going away thanks to mobile. Just want to kind of get your thoughts on that and see. Do you believe that handhelds are eventually going to just be obsolete, and that Nintendo, especially someone who's kind of been the king of it for the last 25 years, is going to eventually just kind of fall by the wayside as far as their handhelds go?
So, our next talking point I really want to get to, because my answer to this, and I'm going to give you an answer to that because it is more specific, but I'm going to shelf.
Okay.
So, but as far as like to answer the specifics of your question that aren't going to be repeated, are they going away? Yes.
Yeah.
But I think that what the alternative we're gonna get, which you can do now, you can wirelessly pair if you really want, like a PlayStation controller, right, to your iPad or your, you know, tablet, whatever you use, and like, it's only when that's easy and it's like a compact thing you can just pull it out of your purse, right? I don't know why I pull this in purse specifically, but okay. Pull it out of your purse and just, you know, hold it in your hands and put the phone in your lap, or maybe it'll clip in or something.
For sure.
That's still, that's where it's probably going to go. And at that point, Yeah, I think handhelds will die.
I want to touch on a couple of comments, and then I'll get to my point on it. So Bobby Beetle says, oh, dang, I still have my copy of Spirit Tracks on DS. That's what's up. Katrin says, I just traded my 3DS XL in for a 360 in Red Dead. That should tell you something. It really should, though.
But that Red Dead, though.
That Red Dead.
You know, thanks for supporting us Martians. We very much appreciate it. You know, us Martians always enjoy people named Katrin. It's very nice of you, ma'am. If I'd had, I'd tip it to you.
I'll tip it to you.
You know, tip is.
Thank you. So, as far as the handhelds go, I mean, Nintendo is actually starting to develop mobile games. So I feel like that's kind of the answer to our question is...
Yeah, you're
Nintendo
right.
Start,
about that.
Start developing mobile games. And, you know, there's rumors that this... the codename NX that Nintendo is working on their next console is actually a cross between a handheld and a dedicated homing console that you can just plug into your television. So
what I think that is, and I'm willing to... you heard it here first, right? Everyone knows about the technology to cast, right? You can Chromecast. You got things like that, right?
You can podcast. You can broadcast.
I mean... Yes. But in this instance... I want to play a video on the TV, right? I have a Chromecast. Bring it up on my phone, hit it. It plays it on the TV. I can, you know, skip back and forth on my phone in real time.
Yeah.
But it's fully resolution on my television. What I think the NX is going to be, and this is just a prediction.
Okay.
It's going to be handheld, pretty decent hardware, but it's going to come with, like, very much how you can pull out the stylus, right?
Yeah.
Like a little bitty, like, dongle, which I hate that word. But, you know, it's what it is. With USB, you plug it in, and you can, like, oh, well, you're on the go, you can play it. Oh, you're at home? You know, there's a separate, like, third-party controller or whatever, or you can play it off the thing still, and you can cast it to the TV.
Yeah,
and just use that as a keypad, or as an input.
I think the Wii U is any indication, I think that makes a lot of sense.
So that's where I think it's going to be going. But
so, yeah, we'll see. I legitimately think the Nintendo handhelds are...
dead.
Yeah, pretty much. I think... the PlayStation Portables and PlayStation Vita, I think we've kind of seen probably the last one of those for at least a while. I think mobile's kind of where it's going.
So before,
everybody has one.
They're like assholes, right? Everyone's got one.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. So before we move on, two things.
Yeah.
One, I feel like we're sitting really close, and when I keep looking at you, it's like we're going to kiss or something. And two, I mean, perhaps we are. Stay tuned to Prep 8 to find out. I just feel like we're sitting awfully close tonight. That's, hey, you know what? It's been a rough week, and perhaps sometimes we need a little bit of closeness. And number two, let's plug real quick before we move on.
Okay.
You want to do the honors?
Yeah, absolutely. So, we're Chainsaw Ape. I'm Major Tom. This handsome fellow that just stepped away out of the camera is...
DKP. Nice to meet you.
So, we stream six nights
John
a week.
Marston.
John Marston, exactly. We stream six nights a week right here on twitch.tv/chainsawape. You can follow us on Twitter. You can subscribe on our YouTube channel or just check out our YouTube channel. We put every episode of Preparation Ape every Monday morning is when you get them uploaded.
So if you want to watch this again,
of course you
without
do.
The shitty Twitch player,
of course you
go
do.
To our YouTube channel. It's
so yeah, give us hit that subscribe button on that channel. We got some other produced content that DKP put together.
Did you just call me DK Poo, you motherfucker? You know I've killed people for less than
one of them Freudian slips. But as far as the Twitch channel goes, do us a favor and click that heart button. Give us a follow. The more followers we get, the bigger we get, the better chance we have of getting rich and famous and quitting our day jobs.
I just hope you didn't think it sucked. Yeah. Just check that sick Wayne's World callback.
I heard it. It was really good. is there any other places people can find us? The Twitters, the Twitches.
Yeah, basically.
The Tubes. Instagram. Yeah, you can follow us on Instagram.
And do us a favor. If you follow... come back.
Yeah, come back and hang out with us.
We get awful lonely sometimes streaming by ourselves.
It's true, we do.
And Javi, I promise I'll never stick you with an AIDS needle. Guaranteed. Never going to let that one time he professed his fear to me was that, like, if he didn't give change to a homeless man, he's going to poke him with a needle or something, and he's going to have a disease. I was like, that is the most irrational fear I have ever heard, and I've never forgotten it. Okay, anyways, we move on.
Yeah.
So, Next talking point we got, mobile industry overall.
Yep.
And this one...
it's huge.
I'm excited to talk about. I'm chomping at the fucking bit to
I'm
talk
sure
about
I'm sure
you
this. Are. So let me go into it first, because I don't hate it as much as you do. So I do believe...
You don't got to give it away.
Oh, I'm like they couldn't tell based on the previous conversation. Of the mobile games that exist, there are probably about a million of them.
Mm-hmm.
Literally.
Yep.
I'd say we're talking like 0.5% are decent. With a normal console, you're talking 10, 20, 30% depending on your play style. But with the mobile industry, there is so much clutter and garbage. But there are good games. There are a lot of solid games. They may not have the same standard models. They may not play the same. But they have these little ways of hooking you. And, you know, I always appreciated that about them. It's not like you're going to get on there and play a perfect game of Super Mario Brothers with jumping and things like that.
No, you're absolutely right. You won't.
But you will find addictive mechanics in collecting cards, or you will find addictive mechanics in trying to level something up, or, you know, the Candy Crush sagas of the world. I mean, I know dozens and dozens of people that have spent hundreds of dollars on, like, one particular mobile game. So it is a very active industry, and it is...
I know those people, too.
Yeah.
They're called fucking idiots. Gotcha. No, I'm just kidding. But I really meant
But, to. Yeah, I think it's definitely something that's going to stick around. I think a lot of people, it's really easy and convenient for them to play on tablets and smartphones and things like that. I mean, I can say, like, when I go home and I lay in bed and I pull out the iPad, I'll play some simple, straightforward games on it. I'm not going to play through Bioshock.
What are you playing?
So I played a lot of Marvel Puzzle Quest, which is like a match 3 game, like Bejeweled or Candy Crush. But it's Marvel, and you collect comic book covers, and there's like an RPG going on at the top. Yeah, sure.
No, like I'm not trying to be patronizing to you. I'm just thinking about
you can no
what you just
you
said.
You can see the patronizing.
No, I swear to Christ, like what you just said reminded me of another thing that I hate about mobile.
Please
that's,
continue.
That's for later.
No, go ahead. Tell us all about your love of mobile.
So you like to know my opinion on the mobile industry overall.
Yeah. Specifically the future of the mobile industry.
Okay, well, then I'm going to talk about the future, assuming the current trends continue. So, there was once a time when I was a huge mobile gamer. Believe it or not.
I don't believe it.
Well, believe it. It's back when Snake and Tetris were on them. And that was like, you got your phone, or you got, you know, someone else's phone. It's like, they got fucking Snake on here! Fuck yeah! Or Tetris, you know. It was wonderful.
Yeah.
It's four-directional. I got him on there. You know, you got little kind of Nokia tactile feedback or whatever.
Yeah.
Then the touch screen came about. And, all right, let's cut the shit. Mobile gaming is the worst thing that has ever happened to the video gaming industry. Now, you look at Konami and you're like, man, at least they're not going into mobile. But what else are they doing?
Oh, they're
going
into
fucking
mobile.
Pachinko machines.
Yeah.
Which is the same thing. It's like, all right, well, It's a fucking McNugget party. It's like, who really wants Silent Hill on mobile or Silent Hill fucking pachinko game? Ah, you know what? This is wonderful. New Final Fantasy game coming out, right? Wonderful. I can't wait. Holy shit. Guess what? Purely mobile.
So,
did you like it? No.
So
who
to
the
me,
fuck wants that?
To me, those experiences are not the games that
I need some preparation
most...
ape because my ass is chapped.
R.I.P. Kojima, Bible thump.
I know, right?
True story. So, to me, those are not the experiences that are worth time on mobile. I don't think the good Nintendo games are going to be like Mario.
So,
I think it's going to be the games that work with touch input designed into it.
I find that it's, but a lot of the IPs that are coming out, they're almost like insulting. Like, oh, Marvel, fuck yeah. What do we got? Is it like superheroes? Well, kind of. What do? Do you like shoot? You Iron Man? Do you get the visor? Like, well, you know, it's...
You match some gyms.
Well, what you do is basically we just shoehorned it in here. It's like, why? No, fuck off. Like, yeah, it's exactly that. It's money.
Well,
you know, and that's all mobile gaming is.
In regards to the
future.
And
it's killing regular gaming and regular IPs.
It is not killing it.
It is, or certain IPs at least.
I wouldn't say it's killing it. We're still getting a new Final Fantasy game. Just because we got them on mobile doesn't mean that we're not.
Do you think if mobile gaming wasn't a thing, wasn't huge like it is, we might still have Kojima working at Konami and Silent Hill coming out before they went, whoa, holy shit. We could spend like a 16th of the money and make 3 times.
I think that we could absolutely speculate that. But it's
well, of
still
course.
Pure speculation.
So if you had to give it a percentage chance. No.
I'm going to even go a little high. I'm going to say 40% chance.
That's a fucking pretty good one. Okay. Yeah, thank you.
40% chance that the mobile industry has impacted the industry that we know now. But if you think about it from a business perspective, it's like the cost, like the ROI for something like a mobile game.
Do you remember what I said at the very beginning? Which was, there's going to be a lot of, I know it makes sense for the business, but I'm speaking purely as a consumer, and like, I'm upset and bummed.
A rising tide makes all boats float, or something like that.
What the fuck? You don't even give me a proper analogy, and you're like, do you get it?
But you know what I'm saying? But
what floats your boat? Is that what you're trying to say?
No, what I'm saying is that more people are playing video games because of mobile. It's in the hands of more people, so more people are spending money on video games, so it's getting in the mind of more people, so the water is rising, and all the boats in the water...
We talked about that back when we did the podcast.
All the boats in the water tend to go up.
And we just have a fundamental disagreement, like, on that. So yes, like, here's the thing. If you don't play games at all, never have, and you're like, man, I really want this industry to succeed. I want there to be video games forever.
Yeah.
Then you're really going to be rooting for mobile. Because you are correct. It's bringing a ton of people in. But my mother's like, hey, you want to play Words of Friends with me? And I'm like, yes. No, that's actually a good time. I know you'll be watching this. Anyways. But no, like, even my mother fucking plays games, right?
Yeah.
And it's like, now, that's bringing a ton of revenue. And yes, you're right. Ton of money coming into these companies. So, let me post to you the consequence of that. What incentive did they have to make way less money, spend way more development cost, when people are flooding in on mobile? Mobile's just getting bigger, swallowing IPs that used to be full-fledged releases, but now they're fucking puzzle games, as an example. And for people that are gaming enthusiasts, it is almost nothing but bad.
I think that makes total sense. I think one of the bigger pieces is that games are bigger and crazier and more expensive.
Yes,
they take significantly more people than they ever have before. I think that has just as much of a chance of ruining AAA franchises and IPs as mobile does. I think they both could have the same effect on it, and you could put blame on either of those things as to why the industry didn't go in a particular direction.
Well, never mind. I'm not going to get into that whole thing. We don't have time for that. But no, I see what you mean. I don't quite agree 100% on that.
It's okay.
Because, like, okay, what happened? Well, because think about it. No, I don't think that. When games got too big and too expensive, right, what happened? Well, same sort of games, just a little bit smaller scope, indie titles came out.
Yeah.
But if you remove that, it's like, well, then fuck, let's just have them all mobile. It's like, well, I guess I'm stuck living on 2015 and under as far as games coming out, you know?
But mobile is not a guaranteed, like, way to make money. Mobile games still have
It's not, and that's the other thing that's wrong with it. It's that there's so many knockoffs, so many free-to-play versions,
like
so
I
much
said,
deceptive 0.5% advertising.
0.5% is probably decent.
And also, not to mention, at least in its current state, which, you know, current state, never mind. We should go in. I was going to say it's run by two companies who get to dictate what content's on there. But that can change, so let's not worry about that. Yeah, anyone can just flood it in there. It's like when Steam Greenlight hit, and they didn't have, like, really any checks on it. It just flooded with bullshit.
Yeah, absolutely.
And it's like, but at least they roped it in. We're like, whoa, hold on. But they haven't done that. And it's because it's not worth it for them.
For sure.
It's still money that's being brought into the App Store, so. Yeah. I don't know.
Makes sense.
Because I think mobile games is great, and it's the future, and I think everyone should, you know.
Let's get rid of consoles.
Yeah, fuck everything.
Fuck Kojima. Fuck Igarashi.
I want every game when I'm using, like, two thumbs to slide past the point where I can actually control it, and then the virtual joypad to swing back to the dead zone.
I can't wait.
It's great.
I can't wait for every Zelda game in the future for me to be swiping on the screen.
Yeah, you're going to be going, ah. You know, I remember back in the day, it was so fucking inconvenient to do this. Way more inconvenient to do this. This is just I don't even have to look. It's fucking great.
Yeah.
So mobile gaming, bleh. Bleh. We move on.
I don't hate it, but I'm not I don't spend my time with it either. So, all right. So, the next thing we want to discuss are kind of the different control input options, alternatives. So, you think about VR, you know, people kind of see like the PlayStation Move as like a good way to kind of, you know, it's like a Wii controller that's got a trigger on it and things like that. And you can aim and shoot. And then we had the Kinect where you can just kind of wave your arms in front of it. And even, like, the Oculus Rift is going to have this thing that attaches to your fingers and it has like sensors and stuff. So like if you squeeze it,
magic fingers.
So there are a lot of alternatives for input. Even the PlayStation controller, PlayStation 4 controller has like a touchpad, like swiping thing that you can use to kind of zoom in and zoom out on maps and stuff like that. I want to see what your thoughts are on this.
So I almost,
in regards to the future,
I almost fucked up and thought we were still talking about mobile, and I was going to go, well, at least that has buttons beside it, but no. Yeah. So I think that, I gotta be honest, like DualShock 4, in my opinion, if we're talking just controller, like peripheral, right, is the best controller that has ever come out. That touchpad actually works really well, surprisingly. Yeah. You get a, as a matter of fact, you can actually control your PC from it, which I found out kind of by accident. By the way, yeah, absolutely hashtag magic fingers. It's so like, I don't know, man. I don't have a lot to say as far as control input. Like, there's keyboard and mouse, which yeah. for certain types of games, like I won't play first person shooters on controller if I can avoid it. Everything else, I mean, for the most part, I'm okay with, right? But I don't know how the future's gonna go for that. Like, if you want to talk about like, control input options, well, let's go back to really quick the VR thing, right? There's gonna be something. That allows you to walk around, which they have.
Yeah.
But it's not really what I would say feasible for home use at this point. It's very expensive. You know, it's like if you want this big kind of octagon thing, you know, in your house. Yeah, I don't really know, man. That's like something that I can't really... As you know, I'm a visionary. I should be wearing a fucking turtleneck. I'm so incredibly... No, but like, I don't know. As far as future input options, like I said, if we don't move away from just your standard controllers and it ain't touch screen, and there's the magic fingers thing you talked about, which I could maybe dig that actually, but I don't really know.
I think that it will continue to evolve, but I think that there will always be a place for controllers. At least I hope.
Yeah.
It's all hope at that point. But I expect, like, you know, one of the kind of big messages that's been strewn across this whole episode is that options, there will always be options. I feel like there's always a place for those types of games, like mobile. There's a place for VR. There's a place for, like, MOBAs.
You know what there are?
There's a place for all of this stuff.
Mobile, and I believe there is a place, and it's in the fucking trash. How about that?
I believe that there is a place for controllers, and I think that there always will be, at least as long as I'm around. Giggity. All right. I'm good on that. So you want to talk about the PC gaming industry?
Yeah, we only got three more points because we're hitting up on our hour, which is
we are, yeah.
And so, we also be streaming. There is a Mega Man remake, not a remake. It was a fan, pretty much a fan game called Mega Man Reborn or something. But and it's not like ripping off Transformers.
Yeah,
it's all the original like Robot Masters have been rebuilt and are out for revenge. They got the bloodlust.
We'll be playing that a little bit later this evening.
Yes, and around, let's see, we're going to wrap, let's say, in like 10 minutes.
I would say we'll probably wrap in like 20 minutes.
Okay, then maybe like 11:15 or something like that. Yeah, we'll check out the Twitter for when we go live. Absolutely. But anyway, so yeah, we got three more things. PC gaming industry, next one.
That's an industry that was, I would say, very, very successful in the 80s, 90s, and then kind of in the between 2000 and 2010, it kind of went on a lull, and it lost a little bit of steam. And then steam.
Hurry, get my ribs, hurry! That was wonderful.
Boo. Thank you. So, and then Steam came out, and it just kind of changed things. Like, it changed the model by which you collect games. It changed the model by which you download them, how you access them, the convenience of them. And I just want to see, like, what do you think of the future for PC gaming?
I mean, that's kind of our, like, it's always going to be there. In fact, I do think that inevitably it's going to be... I don't want to say
like
anything.
The last man standing.
I don't want to say. Well, yeah, it's always gonna be the last man standing because everyone has to have computers, right? Consoles.
At least for now.
You could throw out the consoles today if you wanted. If you wanted, like I would. Yeah. I'm not saying like oh, consoles are garbage, right? Don't. But like, society would function without consoles.
Yeah.
Society right now is built not to function without computers.
For sure.
So, when you talk about last man standing, yeah, of course, I think that, you know, if you talk about PC. Most people think laptop, desktop.
Yeah.
You want to know the real fucking unfortunate scenario that I'm posing? It almost looks like the T-1000, right? Like, or the rise of the Terminators coming up, and they're all fucking mobile devices here to kill our PCs and consoles and handhelds.
They're taking them out one at a time, bro. Well, if you think about, we're gonna go back to mobile for a second, but if you think about like how fast the mobile technology has evolved.
Right.
Like, you know, 10 years ago mobile, we could only play Snake and Tetris because that's all they could run. And now they can, like, you can, like I said, Bioshock. You can play Bioshock on it. It's kind of a dumbed down version. But the technology for mobile phones is moving so fast and they iterate on them so frequently that we are going to get to the point to where mobile devices are matching that of a high-end PC.
The only thing that could possibly kill PC surpassing it would be mobile devices.
For sure.
And, I mean, for personal use, when it makes more sense for developers to make it for that than it is for people that own, you know, laptops, desktops.
Yeah.
And PC, as far as that computing power that you need, right, will just be a thing that's, you know, industry tech needs that. Servers need that.
For sure.
Let's say hypothetically that doesn't happen. Those have got to be that, let's see, show me a mobile developer that develops higher quality games on a mobile phone, desktops,
we'll never go.
I don't know, man. I don't want them to, but yeah, we're talking about the future, man.
Yeah. We'll see.
Yeah, so, I don't know, if it continues, hypothetically, mobile didn't come in and murder it, right?
Yeah.
It definitely has to be the last man standing. Not to mention,
for sure.
I think that whenever there is a point where there's no more consoles, and let's say, for example, it's no more consoles, it's all streaming stuff, right? Mm-hmm. Well, people are like, well, we're streaming the game here, and it's just that easy. And then there's these other, like, things. You can just buy them. There's a huge library there. You can just download and play or stream. People are going to start kind of cross-sampling. It might stick around with Steambox or something like that. You know, like I said, it's never going to be a point where PC is fucking gone before consoles is. Consoles will die out way before PC.
I would agree.
That's because, you know,
well, just the way that they're designed, the way they're built.
They're multi-purpose too, you know.
Yeah.
But like I said, so if you want to talk about the future of PC, the future of that sort of industry, I think it's going to be the cockroach of it if the mobiles don't come in and eventually murder it, take it over. Because a lot of people these days, like a lot of people I know, they don't have PCs. They do everything on their mobile, and they also play games. They play games on their mobile. Younger generations. How many younger kids, like in the age of, like, let's say 7 to 16, have laptops that they're not like college, right? That at this point, and they're also now there's the keyboards and shit too. So like that was the thing you really needed it for. So even the younger generation is mostly just going on handheld devices at this point.
Definitely.
And they're going to be the ones who mostly dictate what fucking, you know, what develop, because you gotta develop games for the biggest systems, biggest platforms.
Yep.
So future PC game, in my opinion, it's either going to be great, or at least, you know, it can't die, or mobile's going to come in and brutally murder it.
Yeah.
So,
just to touch on a couple of comments, Javi says, make sure that we save these to see how accurate we are for the future. Let's see how long lasts.
I know what's going to happen.
So, I'm a Nerd says, game streaming is decades out. For sure. The internet infrastructure is nowhere near close enough. I would agree with that. Karen says, even fucking 5-year-olds have iPads. It's true. Absolutely true. I'm a Nerd says, mobile gaming is a flash in the pan. It brought in a new market, and people correlate its growth with a shift in gaming demographics. I don't believe that it's necessarily a
shift. That's what I hope it is only, but...
Yeah. I don't believe that it's just like a trend or a fad. I believe it's going to be here for a while. So,
because there was a point when everyone had, you know, laptops or whatever that needed to do that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And that was just, not everybody, but that was a lot of people. Everybody has cell phones or mobile devices. Yep. Everybody.
Yep.
So,
let's move on. We got two more things, and then I want to go talk to you guys for a little bit. So one of the things that I've noticed has been a more consistent trend, and it's been around for PC gaming for a long time, but it's starting to hit the console world, is multiplayer only games.
I seen the 3-year-old, the audacity,
the audacity,
oh, the audacity.
So multiplayer only
and
games. So
consequently the humanity.
It's kind of been around for a while, and especially like MOBAs and stuff like that, they're free to, or they're multiplayer only. They're like multiplayer games have kind of been around.
Mm.
Multiplayer only games like Counter-Strike, stuff like that. But we're starting to see a big trend with it in the console market. So, you know, Titanfall, we have Star Wars Battlefront coming out.
Right.
The new Call of Duty that's coming out, Call of Duty Black Ops 3. The previous gen console version, so 360 and PS3, will be multiplayer only.
Mm.
You will not be able to get a campaign if you buy Call of Duty Black Ops on Xbox 360.
No shit.
Yeah.
Hey, man, if You gotta do what you gotta do.
Yeah, the new Rainbow Six game, Rainbow Six Siege, that's gonna be multiplayer only. We had games like Evolve that came out, so just want to get your thoughts on that whole situation, and do you feel like we're gonna get to the point to where even like the Halos of the world and all this kind of stuff are multiplayer only?
So, I don't know, a lot of people's gripe with multiplayer only games, and I totally get it. And, and this is the biggest kind of concern. It's what happens when the servers go away, right?
Definitely.
So, my opinion on mobile gaming is simple and concise. One,
mobile gaming or multiplayer only?
I can't get away from it. Multiplayer gaming. Like, yeah. Multiplayer only games. So, if it doesn't have a single player campaign, multiplayer only, right? And there's not any way you can play it offline with friends, right? It's all dependent on servers.
Yeah.
Then, charge it for free. Or, if it is paid, then, and by free, I mean, like, do it free-to-play. Yeah. And I'm not a big fan of free-to-play, but I don't want to buy a $60 game that one day I will not be able to play anymore.
For sure.
So, and here's the other alternative for that. I'll pay you $60 if we have an understanding, and, you know, it might be out $60 if you don't honor that, but you want to take the servers down, release the source code or something where someone else, fans of the game, if there are any, can come together, rent their own servers, and keep it going.
Yeah.
And you're not going to cease and desist them. You're not going to do any of that shit. They can just run their own little private servers. So that way, even 30 years from now, no one's playing on a Rainbow Six Siege. No one's playing whatever. But, you know, there are some people that are emulating servers and playing.
Yeah.
If you allow people to do that, you give you actually give that, like, you know, however it aid them in that, then I think it's fine to charge a full $60 for it. If there's the possibility that someone's going to give you $60 as a purchase, and then at one point in the future, I mean, it could be tomorrow. Let's say the company just tanks for some unknown reason. They have to, you know, liquidate all their shit. It's gone. And there's no... Then no, do it free to play. And if people want to pay for extra shit, they can. And if not, at least they're not like, well, at least I didn't blow out like a ton of money when this game just goes away. You know what I mean? And even that's not a really good like alternative with the free to play thing, because all that content you did pay for goes with it. But...
It's true.
You know... That's the only really thing with... There's nothing wrong with a game not having a single-player campaign. The only thing wrong with it is just the fact that if it's server-based, it's just going to go away one day. That's it.
It's true.
That's the end of it.
I think my biggest issue with it, at least in the present, as far as the future is concerned, I think we are going to see a lot more of it. But in the present is, I want to play a Rainbow Six Siege campaign. I want to play a Titanfall campaign. I want to play a Star Wars Battlefront campaign. So... For someone who actually prefers single player to multiplayer, it is kind of a hassle for me because I'm never ever going to be the best at any of those games. I'm never going to be able to commit the amount of time. It's true. I'm never going to be able to commit the amount of time needed to kind of like achieve greatness in those games. And I'm not going to have that feeling of accomplishment like I do with a lot of single
player stuff. Someone mentioned Pogo. Anyways.
Oh, Pogo. I think that's kind of it. And our last topic is free to play. We've touched on quite a bit.
To touch on what you said, the whole multiplayer thing. That's very much almost like mobile gaming too. Like, if it's pushing toward that's more popular, you might have a story based series that you like, and now it's no longer there because it's multiplayer only. Like, I'm more of a single player person or play with friends, that sort of thing in general. But yeah, it's. I feel your pain, though.
Yeah. Well, imagine if the next Metal Gear, which we're not going to get one, but at least anytime soon. Imagine if the next Metal Gear was multiplayer only.
Then I just really wouldn't give a shit. Like, if it was story-based somehow.
Imagine if GTA Online is very successful. Imagine if the next GTA is online only. Like, no thank you.
Darth Axis writes, DKB, how would it make you feel to be holding the disc to a game that had its server shut down that you can't play anymore? Well... Not good. I have about 10,000 World of Warcraft ones that one day I'll be holding. So, no, like that's the other thing. Like, hey, here it is. Yep. But fuck you. You can't authenticate, or you know.
Bobby Beetle says, "Wait, terrible. Rainbow Six Siege is multiplayer only. Everyone trying to get that esports money. Yes, sir. It is multiplayer only, and yes, they want that esports skrill. Got to get the skrill. So,
and also one more question. Your fucking grandma, Zod. We have the same grandma, and you know she's dead."
I heard it, like, echo through.
I know, cool, right?
Really cool.
Yeah, it really echoes.
Yeah. So our last topic we touched on quite a bit throughout this entire episode, but that's free to play. So free to play has been around 5-6 years, and I feel like it's going to continue, and I feel like it's going to get bigger and bigger. I think that a lot of games are going to go that direction. So hashtag feedback.
No, I think we should be hashtagging Magic Fingers still.
Okay.
Or Clump and Seal.
Yeah, that's actually one of the things in our Twitter. Yeah, Clump and Seal, Tom Hanks.
Yes. You got a hashtag Clump and Seal. I'm going to at Tom Hanks.
That's right. If you guys have any feedback for us on Twitter, if you hashtag feedback it, make sure you add Tom
Hanks. And if Tom Hanks, if you're watching in the archive, I thought you were really great in Turner and Hooch. Thank you.
Not as good as the dog, though.
Which Hooch was infinitely better.
Which one was Turner and which one was Hooch? Well,
Tom Hanks was Turner.
Okay.
Lieutenant Turner. Okay. Tina Turner is his name.
Clump and Seal sounds like kitty litter.
Ooh. That's actually what it was. Ooh. The whole thing came from, so on the Amazon Prime Day or whatever it was, I was looking through and I was like, okay, what the fuck is this garbage?
Yeah.
And it's like, so some headphones, kitty litter. And I was like, special Clump and Seal kitty litter. And I was like, you know, this sums up the whole Prime Day thing for me. Like, I'm going to buy, it's Prime Day, like the second Black Friday. And I'm going to buy something my cat is literally, like, it's intended just to shit on. Like, if it happens by accident, like, well, that's shame on me, right?
Yeah.
But, like,
ooh, I'm
intentionally, yeah, like, ooh, it clumps and seals? Why, that's tremendous. I'll take three. It's like, so.
What a value.
I wait all year for Prime Day to buy something I want my cat to piss and shit on. That, okay. Prime Day was a disaster.
Yeah, it was.
It was hashtag clump and seal, baby.
So, as far as free-to-play, I think we talked about it quite a bit. I think it's the future. I don't think it's the forever future, but I do think we're going to see a lot more.
Well, haven't we been talking about the forever future?
Are we talking? There is no forever future.
You just said forever future. What the fuck does that even mean?
What it means is that it's not going to be the most common thing from here on out. we're going to get...
Okay.
What I talked about earlier, we're going to get the ebbs and the flows.
Oh, it's going to bob and weave.
It's going to trend.
Like Muhammad Ali,
it's going to come up, it's going to go down.
It's going to first
all
sting
of this stuff that we've talked about like is going to evolve. It's just going to continue to...
Okay.
To blossom. So, Darth Axis says, I'm not an Xbox guy, but they had it right when I could plug multiple consoles into each other and can do multiplayer, even without Wi-Fi. I wish that type of thing was still something that was a need for games. Yeah, for sure.
Local multiplayer is lacking big time. It's a great feature.
So that's pretty much it for our talking points. I wanted to take a couple of minutes.
We didn't talk about free-to-play.
Yeah, we did. We talked about it the whole fucking time.
I didn't say
And while we were talking about it, even at the end, I said, we've talked about it the whole fucking time.
Well, I don't like it.
All right.
But it's okay at the same time.
You got anything
time.
Else to say on free-to-play?
Well, no, not really. Besides being like, well, this is good free-to-play, and then I'm going to bitch and moan about the other kind for a minute. But I think we've had enough of that, don't you think?
Yeah,
let's do a little bit of Q&A.
So, yeah, I want to see if you guys listen, DKP. He's
Look,
right.
The subtlety of what we're actually talking about was too much. I just couldn't do it.
I guess so. So we want to turn it over to you guys, see if you have any questions for us about the stream or about the product. We want to see if you have any feedback, but also want to kind of get your thoughts on the future of the gaming industry. Is there anything that we didn't touch on that you guys, you know, want to talk about, or what do you think is part of the future gaming industry? So let us know what you think. Fuck. Premium isn't free.
No,
I
was laughing at Hoffy's, because I read it. I read premium isn't free, then I read Hobby's comment, folks like you and me.
And I was a hefty fucking
fee. Fucking asshole.
Everybody's rhyming right now. So yeah, let us know what you guys think. Maybe not think, but specifically, I guess, regarding the
I don't know.
Future.
It's open forum right now.
Yes, open forum. Whatever you guys want to talk about. We'll be around for about 5-10 more minutes before we end it for the night. We got some winky faces.
Well, we'll be coming back.
Yeah.
And we will be coming back. And I'm bringing my new toys with me.
And
it's the most ambiguously, possibly sexual phrase from Silent Hills. Go on.
No. If you don't pay your $1.05, who will? Premium cost $1.05. $3.50.
$1.05?
Yeah.
I've got nothing on that one.
Nope.
Us Martians ain't quite quick on the joke when it comes to financial figures. I'm awful sorry, ma'am. Nope. The boy wasn't Prime Day a fucking disaster, though.
It really was. It really was.
I was really happy to go online and see all news stories of people just shitting all over it. It's like when you walk into Radio Shack these days, and it's like...
Wait, those still exist?
Yeah, they fucking totally. I went to try to buy some batteries, like some weird watch ones recently, and it's like, okay, headphones, Beats audio.
Ooh.
No thanks. What? more Beats audio. Beats audio. It's not a Radio Shack. It's a fucking headphone store now.
Yeah.
And they got the cell phone kiosk in there. It's just, it's awful. It's terrible.
So Darth Axis has a question. How do you guys feel about cross-platform multiplayer? Whether more games are going to do that, like Final Fantasy, you can play with PS3 and 4 from your PC. I think it's a cool idea. I think that there's a lot of restrictions behind it. I'd like to see more of it in the future.
I think that it's a really great idea, minus really competitive games. So like, for example, I would
definitely not cross play with PC.
That's what I mean. Like, yeah. And I'm not. It's because like in a shooter, if you're a controller versus PC. Like keyboard and mouse, shooter wise, or RTS. Those are like pretty much the only two ones really. You're pretty much fucked. You're not gonna compete.
I would love to see a game that's like called Console Wars, and it's a multiplayer shooter, and whatever console you play on is like what team you play on.
Well, I think we should every time that you play and not on deliver and then steal the money and make our stream better. What do you think about that?
Sounds good. But whichever console you play on, that's the team you play on. So if you play on PlayStation,
okay, terrific.
If you had both consoles, you could switch it up.
But thanks for the follow, everybody. Very much appreciated. We're trying to hit 400 this weekend. We got like 23 more to go.
Tell your friends.
And we're going to be marathoning Silent Hill tomorrow.
Yeah.
And yes, I didn't like Kami's comment. You know, Radio Shacks is like Randall's.
I got nothing.
Let's see. So before we start hamina, anything else from you guys?
PC versus console and shooter skills is like manual driver versus auto driver.
Yeah, it really
probably
is.
Fucked as the auto. True story.
But I like to use the term hashtag fugged.
Yep.
Make sure you at Tom Hanks on this one. But, absolutely. Yeah. All right, well, I think if that's pretty much all the questions you guys have. We'll be back on in about probably 30 minutes, 45 minutes maybe, yep, with Mega Man Fall of Zod or some shit. I don't know. It looks really great, and it's plug and play. We got it going, finally.
Yeah.
Did have a little bit of tech issues like the last 2 weeks. So anyways, thanks everyone for joining. If you haven't, make sure you check us out in 45 minutes. And tomorrow night, when we're going to marathon, quote unquote, we're going to play all the way through and beat the very first Silent Hill. It's going to be a pisser. Make sure you join. Planning on going live at around anywhere from 8 to 9 Central Standard Time tomorrow. But keep updated on the Twitter, which, you know, we will plug and all that.
Yep. Follow us on Twitter.
And YouTube. I've been making some videos there for a while. Plus, this will be here. But the big important thing is definitely follow us here and come back. We stream 5 nights a week, sometimes 6. Fuck, sometimes 7. It just depends.
Yep.
But pretty much no less than 5. It's a good time. And it's very sensual. Yes.
So, thank you guys so much. I'm Major Tom.
Well, Darth Axis. Hope to see you tomorrow. Everyone else, very much thank you for joining us and helping us shoot the shit during Prep Ape.
Absolutely.
Hope you guys had fun. We'll see you guys here not too long from now, hopefully. And if not, see you tomorrow.
I'm Major Tom.
Jerry Randall.
And that's it.
I don't know who Jerry Randall is.
I don't either. It doesn't matter.
DKP. Goodbye.
Bye, everybody.
God damn, man. I've had a fucking a hemorrhoid on my ass that I have just been this whole fucking time. It's awful.